Grammy Award winning super producer Rodney Darkchild Jerkins is an actual urban legend in the flesh. An acknowledged virtuoso in the music industry, Jerkins began his career as a prodigy at the age of 15 and has been an in-demand producer since his early beginning. Megastars line up to work with him to ensure that next smash. Born the youngest son of a minister father and choir director mother in Pleasantville, New Jersey in 1977, Jerkins began taking classical piano lessons as a child and combined that with the gospel music that he heard in church. This singular background empowers him to consistently craft hits for a who's who of iconic artists, including Michael Jackson, Whitney Houston, Jay-Z, Beyonce, Jennifer Lopez, Justin Bieber, and countless others. Rodney loves his work, and it shows in all the carefully crafted projects that he fashions. His singular focus towards quality and excellence in music is what sets him apart from the rest. Let's give a nice virtual round of applause to Rodney Darkchild Jerkins.
All right, welcome, Rodney. Thank you so much for being with us today here in New York City. I know that you're out on the West Coast, so we appreciate you taking some time out of your busy schedule. We're going to have a couple major artists wait just a minute, for their turn to work with you for that next hit. And so again, thank you. We're so appreciative. These kids are really appreciative, and it means a lot to the school system here in New York City. I know that you're from the East Coast, as we just heard in the sizzle reel. Can you tell us a little bit about, growing up in Jersey, what that was like for you?
Yeah, growing up where, there wasn't really a musical outlet. My mother and father instilled music in our house at a young age. My dad kind of had this house rule that if you lived in our house, you had to play the piano. If not, so you had to go somewhere else. So at 5 years old, my mother was a housekeeper, and she met a piano teacher at a house that she was taking care of, and she asked him, "Would he teach me?" And at first it was kind of that moment of, "I don't know if you could afford me, but if you think your son has talent and you think he has something, sure, I'll teach him." And so she persuaded him to teach me, and I took classical lessons for 8 years. I played in church as well. I played the drums and played a little bit of keys. My brother was the main keyboardist in church. And I think around 10 years old was when I just grew my love for music production. That's when I was like, heard production, and I was very interested in the sounds and everything that was coming from a song. And I would read credits. That's when credits were very, prominent back then. And I would read the credits, and I would learn who did what and what was what and what parts meant and what that meant for a song. And every day of my life, I dedicated, some type of time to wanting to better myself and to become a music producer.
Yeah, that's amazing. I mean, it comes across in your work because, when I was listening to your catalog last week, getting ready, I was like, man, you're just a good producer, like a really good musician and a good producer, just listening to, the body of work and your legacy. I'd love for you to talk a little bit about the background in the church, because I think that that's like, I think it's really important. And because we've seen major stars like Whitney and Mariah and, other artists that are just, they really honed their skills in church. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's funny you bring that up, because a lot of times I'll tell artists that I work with, I'm like, if you can't find yourself a good church to go to, if you want to be a great artist, find yourself a good church to go to. And they'd be like, why? I say, because you're going to see some of the best singers and some of the best musicians ever in a church that may not be, you know, on the mainstream market. You may not hear them on radio or see them on video platforms each and every day. But when you go to church, you'll be blown away. I mean, I've come across some of the best singers ever just being in church. And so it's also a place where you just get your chops up. You know, the church I grew up, my dad's church was somewhat, it was very, I call it freestyle, because, you know, it was almost like you can just walk up. He would allow people to literally just showcase their gift. You play the instrument. If you walked in and you had an instrument that you play, he would never stop you from going up to the front and playing that instrument. So, you know, it allows you to get your chops up real quick. And it also, for me, I would actually, which is interesting, my studio was actually a block from the church. So I would find myself in church playing ideas and then running, like while my dad was preaching, I would run over to the studio and lay down my idea. Then I would run back to try to, you know, be in the seat that I was in before he was finished preaching. So when he looked over, you know, later on, when he finished, he would be like, did you leave out of church or did you go to the restroom? Where'd you go? Because you were gone for like a half an hour. And I'm like, Dad, I had an idea and I had to run over to the studio and lay it down. I'm sorry. You know, but that, you know, that was just a lot of songs that probably a lot of songs that you guys heard from my catalog. It probably started somewhere for me just being on a keyboard in my dad's church.
That's really cool. That's really cool. You know, it brings me to another thought, you know, that the very name R&B music, you know, Jerry Wexler coined that term. He was a Billboard columnist and then he was a producer at Atlantic. You've probably heard the name. He coined the term, but he always somewhat regretted it, saying, you know, I wish I had called it rhythm and gospel, you know, R&G. Instead of R&B, because he thought, you know, there's so many more like gospel patterns that fit into like what R&B ultimately evolved into than blues patterns, you know. What do you think of that?
I totally agree with that. A lot of R&B, it's funny because, you know, even pop music borrows from R&B. You know, it's funny, I was working on an idea for a documentary called The Genesis. And basically, Genesis is about talking about the root of music. And as I started doing a lot of research, I realized the root of a lot of music came from gospel, came from church, it came from it. A lot of soulful, you know, even hymns, you know, they set the path for a lot of songs today. So, you know, when you hear, certain songs by certain artists and it sounds somewhat familiar to the ear, and you go back and research and it's like, oh, they took that piece from a hymn from, you know, that was from the 1800s or something, you know? A lot of people don't really realize that. That's why I always encourage young artists, musicians, and songwriters to make sure you study your craft and understand where everything came from.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's really important. You know, and whatever it is that, you know, for speaking to the kids now on the call and the student artists, you know, whatever it is that you really love, hone in on that and try to focus on that piece of your craft, you know, and it might be just working with a laptop or something, but make sure that you know how to do that stuff. Make sure if it's going to be that way, you know, Ableton Live inside and out, or if it's primarily vocals that you're really just honing in on it and learning about that. At a deep level, so that you have bandwidth that when you're creating, then you have a lot of options creatively. You don't get stuck in one place, like someone like yourself, you know, a very accomplished musician and accomplished producer, you know, on many levels. So, you know, one other thing that I'd like to talk about, your productions to me, they sound fun and full of life. You know, like when I listened over the journey of a couple years of your work, you know, there's certain sounds. It's almost like I it's hard to explain it. It kind of sounds like you kind of take things, you mash them up a little bit, you make it a little hard to identify, and then it's kind of becomes like a fun piece of ear candy. Could you talk maybe about the process of how you create ear candy like that in some of your tracks? And because I think it's important because it makes it unique, you know.
Yeah, I think I'm always searching, you know, to try to create somewhat hooks, multiple hooks. And what I mean by that is not necessarily the lyric and melody of a hook, but also the hook that's in the production. That you know, that simple something that captures your ear. I'm a strong believer that you don't need a lot of sounds, you need unique sounds. And when you find certain unique sounds, those sounds become what's interesting to everybody else, right? I remember when I worked with Michael Jackson, and it was so interesting because he said, I don't want to hear any of the primitive snares and kicks and that everybody else uses. You know, he was so into pushing the boundary, right? And that pushed me. But I understood it because what he was telling me was to dig deeper, go deeper, and find unique sounds that the world hasn't really heard yet. And so I get super excited when someone hears a track of mine and they go, yo, what is that sound? Like, what sound was that you use? I love that. Like, that really excites me because it's what I'm actually going for. And also, by the way, you know, because, you know, I believe because God created everything that we're heirs to creativity. So we should be creative and we should challenge ourselves to think out the box and find some unique things, you know, some unique sounds that are ear candy and that make the world go, wow, that's different. Oh, that's special. Whatever it is.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. We are heirs to creativity. I mean, the whole universe is one creative product, you know, in a way. Yeah. It's like that continues to evolve and change in a kaleidoscope, you know. Yeah. I don't see us as separate from all that creativity, you know. I totally agree with you. So would you like to hear some New York City students?
Absolutely. I'm thrilled about meeting the squad here.
All right, awesome. So so what we're going to do today is, you know, these kids have all been in something called the Modern Music Project, and it's the debut of a new New York City All-City ensemble. So, you know, kids come from all five boroughs, and they work on Saturday mornings. They're committed to doing that, you know, writing and producing original music. So I figured, you know, it'd be nice to feature their work, their hard work from this school year. So the first song is called Wrong, and this is from Julia Miranda, and she attends Fort Hamilton High School.
You are my everything. Change my mind. I was wrong.
this, I was broke. I was broke. Was way too far to this idea of you. To love someone I thought was easy, but I guess I was broke. I was broke. Was so caught up in this idea of you. To love someone I thought was easy, but I guess I was wrong.
All right, so there was wrong.
Good job, Julia.
Thank you.
So do you have anything you would like to ask Rodney, Julia?
Yeah. So what do you think about my original song? Like in terms of like the songwriting and like the melody and I guess the hook coming with the chorus, is there anything you think I could do different? Yeah.
I would actually like to hear a stripped down version of it, where it's more about you and the message that you're trying to convey, less about the production. Because melodically, I think you get it, you understand. I think sometimes the production fought a little bit with you in terms of maybe a little bit overproduced at times. So I would, as a producer, I would peel back, right? So sometimes what we do is we may produce something really big to start with, and then we go back in and we just start pulling back layers. You're familiar with the artist, her, right? So like when I work with her, that's kind of always how we work. We'll go in and we'll just go and we'll hear so many different things. So many, let's add this guitar, let's add this bass, let's add this, and then we'll start taking it all back and peeling it all back, and that's fine. What really sticks. So for me, like, you know, with the messaging and the melody, I would love to have heard that just a little bit more about you and, you know, maybe guitars, you know, and maybe it builds more. Maybe it's a thing where it incrementally just keeps building to the big crescendo at the end, and then everything's there. That was my really only note for it.
Thank you. So like maybe more guitar then, because originally the song was just me, my voice and my guitar. So
that part, right? It's the first instinct. And I know sometimes it can be tempting to make a song and be like, you know, I want to make something really big and I want to, and you start hearing all these different instruments, but sometimes less is even more.
This is more, right. Thank you.
So, yeah, I mean, if we have time when we get through all the songs, if you feel like you want to grab your guitar and just play it live, that'd be cool.
Yeah, I can definitely do that at the end.
All right, yeah. Let's do that. The next song is called I Will Survive. And this is from Ella Rosenblatt, stage name Ella. And this is from LaGuardia High School. She's from LaGuardia High School.
Without you, I needed you. You were
searching through the night. I will survive, forget the world of you and I. I will survive, pushing through the night. I will survive, forget the world of you.
I love the bridge. I love the bridge, the end of the bridge, those key changes at the very end. That was very unexpected. Love that.
Thank you.
And you're writing, you write older than what you are.
Oh, thank you.
You write from a place of a little bit more mature in your lyric.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Like, okay, how old are you?
15.
Yeah, I was right. Yeah, that's like, that's more of like a 20, 23, 24 year old lyric. You know, that girl who really went through something crazy in her, you know, 18 to 19 year old age and trying to come out of it. And she wants to write from that experience. So you definitely wrote above your age. Really good job.
Thank you.
Do you have any questions you would like to, you have a question you want to ask?
Yeah. I was wondering like what your favorite like song / like collab you've done.
My favorite song collaboration?
Yeah.
That's tough. I always revert back to, for some reason, I always revert back to Say My Name by Destiny's Child. I want to believe that I haven't had my best song yet. I'm still going, so I want to believe there's more greatness to come. But if I had to choose one, if the clock stopped today and it was one I had to choose, I probably would go Say My Name because it was just the way it happened. I was in London working on the Spice Girls, and I discovered a sound over there called UK Garage. It's like a two-step rhythm. And I wanted to bring that back to America because I never heard it over here. So I was like very motivated and inspired to bring that type of rhythm to the US. When I came back, my first session in the US was with Destiny's Child. And I had this track that was really, really bad. Really, 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 really bad. It was so bad that the girls didn't really care to sing the song. But, you know, I kind of pushed them into it and ended up recording this song. No one liked it. It wasn't necessarily the song they liked it. No one liked my track. And, you know, and I kept trying to convince myself that what I did was genius when it was really horrible. And so I never forget the day we had to mix the song, when we had to mix the song. My dear John Marie Horvat, I went into the mix session. I said, do me a favor. I said, strip all of the music out. All I want to hear is their vocals. And I listened to the vocals. And as I listened to the vocals a cappella, I started hearing new music form in my mind. And so I said, I'm going to redo this track. And he said, what? We got to mix it. I was like, no. This can't come out like this. And I redid the whole track, and that track is the track that you guys hear today. So I'm very connected to that song. It was my first Grammy, by the way, too, that I won. So it was like the whole story behind that, you know, for me.
Yeah. That's so cool.
And that's why you never give up on something that you believe in, just because, you know, sometimes we can think we know everything, we you know, but at the end of the day, sometimes you need other people to help you, other people to steer you and tell you, nah, it could be better, it could be better. And if I didn't hear so many no's, I don't know if I would have done that over. But because I heard so many people tell me that it was just okay, it wasn't that great, the song, evidently the song was always great because it's a great song, but the music wasn't there yet. So I had to go back and redo it. And that, you know, for me, that proved something to me in my career, to have endurance, to be able to have endurance, to push yourself to even want to try to do something again is very important.
Yeah, work ethic. I mean, you know, you don't have a track record like yours without without a deep work ethic. You know, it's hard work. You know, people think it's easy to be a creator. It is so not easy to be a creator, and to be a unique creator at the very, you know, top is the hardest thing, you know, because you have to keep being unique, as you know. That's no easy feat.
I have arguments sometimes with my son, and my son will debate about it. He'll go, yeah, what you do is easy. So you can just go, and I say, well, try it.
Yeah, exactly.
Do it.
Yeah, exactly. If pop music is so easy, then take a shot.
I guess.
That's right.
But I love what I'm hearing. I love what I'm hearing from you guys. Just, you know, it's super inspiring to hear young, fresh talent. So I just want to encourage you to keep writing and keep going after it and keep studying. Always very important to study, consume as much music as you can from every genre. Don't be stuck into one genre, because there's something that you can pull from different genres, and you can make it part of your own repertoire. So it's very important that you just study your craft.
Yeah, thank you. Want to hear another one?
Yeah, I'm excited. Yes, let's
go. All right. So this is the name of the song is "Without You," and this is from Angel Soto, and he's from Renaissance High School for Performing Arts.
Oh, I really wish that you could see me now. Oh, I really hope you know I'm trying to make you proud. And oh, I really miss the way that you would cheer me on. But still I can't cope, just can't cope with how long you've been gone. I'll keep on pushing and moving along, but I can't find the words, that's why I wrote this song about you. I'm so lost without you. I can't live without you. The shimmer in your eyes that could light up the sky. Guess I'm gonna have to find my way without you. Guess I'm gonna have to find my way without you.
Very sweet, Angel. Very sweet. Mr. Crooner right there.
I've gotten that a lot. Thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, he's got a beautiful voice, right?
Yeah. Holy.
Thank you again. If I had a question, I guess my question would be, with, you know, how much music you've made and how much music you've been exposed to and like and listened to throughout your career and throughout your life, would you say, like, how often would you say you hear music that like really inspires you? Like there could be music that you like, right? Music that's like, oh, that sounds cool. But how often is it that you hear music and you're like, that's actually, like, that's really awesome and I want to do something like that?
These days, not much. So a lot of times I have to find that inspiration by going back to, you know, different eras. You know, I got to go back to different eras and, you know, see if I can find something that maybe I never discovered before from an era. Or a lot of times when I'm finding like things nowadays is in different countries. So I think the cool thing about the internet, right, is now we can literally hear music from all around the world. And so when I'm hearing different things from different countries, I'm like, I'll hear. I've been hearing like things from like, even from like France, or, you know, and I'm like, wow, that's so cool. Like the instrumentation and different things that they're using over there. And so that's where I'm kind of getting my inspiration from just different countries. Brazil is another great place. I think that's just, you know, it's a great place to pull from. I wanted to ask you, actually, how long did it take you to write that song?
How long did it take me to write the song?
Yes.
maybe, I think I remember writing it in a day.
Because it seems so natural for you.
Yeah, I kind of, I just messed around with, I didn't intend to make it into a song, I guess, but I was messing around like on my piano and I found that thing in the middle. Da, na, 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 na. I found that thing and I was like, that sounds cool. And I want to build around that, I guess. And before I knew it, I had a theme for the song. I had, you know, a thing. And if I may speak a little bit about it, if we're not like short on time or anything, I wrote the song it's dedicated to my mom who passed away almost 5 years ago. And I was going through one of those periods of time where I was just, you know, she was on the mind a lot, and I was just wishing that I could, you know, talk to her and look for guidance from her. And so I decided to write that song. And I'm really happy that you like it.
Yeah, no, I can tell that it came from a very sincere place. And I think that's the best place to write from is honesty, right? From your, you know, your feelings, and, you know, and on top of that, know that, you know, the song's called Without You, that your mother's always with you. And every breathing moment, and every time you touch that piano, and every time you come up with a melody, and every time you come up with a lyric, right there, and she's guiding what you do, you know what I mean? So keep writing from that particular space, from that place of honor, from honesty, and you'll know what I'm talking about, because you'll feel it as you create.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, that's great advice. Doesn't get better than that. Shall we hear one more? Yeah. So this is called The Best Days of My Life. This is from Sophia B. And she's also a student at LaGuardia High School.
Hi, that's me.
I don't want to write a song, I'll write. Will you say goodnight and hold me tight? Don't want to do anything for to walk on my own, but longer just your baby. But you see, I'm no longer just your baby. I don't wanna grow up. Oh, I just wanna show.
Good. Lovely voice.
Hey. Hi. Hey.
You got a great voice. There's a really strong hook, by the way. The chorus is, I love when choruses lift, right? When you're like, when things are here and then that extra, that lift of a chorus is very important in songwriting. It's funny because you wrote the opposite song of a song that I had. I had a song called When I Grow Up that I did with the
Pussycat. Oh, really? Wow.
So, you know, you wrote the other way around, which is really cool. Yeah, no, good songwriting and good energy in that song, for sure.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that. I also have a question. I have two questions. So what could I do to make the song stronger and to like add more to move the story forward? Because I notice in my bridge, I feel like I need to add a little bit more and just to like move people. And also, how do you form relationships with people you collaborate with, like in a band or musicians?
First, I would say go with your gut instinct, right? So you feel, if there's things that you're hearing that you feel needs to be added to the bridge or whatever part, you should just do it, right? And see how it turns out. Nothing hurts to try, first of all. I'm big on stacking vocals to create more, to make it bigger. So if you're looking for it to be become even more bigger, then I would stack, right? And that doesn't mean that necessarily it has to happen in the very first hook or even in the second hook. It could happen after the bridge. So that way it feels like we've lifted off into this big anthemic art. I did a song with Sam Smith called Stay With Me, and we used like big choir vocals, and everybody thought I had a choir, but it wasn't. It was just Sam's vocals that we just stacked real big. So there's ways to do that, you know? So I would suggest that for this particular song, not necessarily a choir. I think that's too big for this song, excuse me. But I would maybe add four more each note.
Like towards the end of the song.
Yes. And panning is very important. And this is for all four of you to learn, right? This is a production note. A lot of times when people are starting out, they make music and they pan their vocals hard left and hard right, right? And when you hear it, that's the way you're gonna hear it. You're gonna hear the background vocals way over here and way over here. Well, if you stack vocals and you continue to stack vocals, be experimental in panning. So you might have the first two go hard, left, hard, right, but then you might have the next one go 3 and 9 o'clock. You know, you might have something going at 1 and maybe off a little bit, like 1 and 10, you know? So, and that what that does, it creates this like around, if someone's listening in their headphones, it creates this like almost like 3D type of feeling for background vocals. I always love to do stuff like that. It's also fun. You can just have fun, and it'll make you hear things differently as you listen to it. You know, oh, I can add another note, and I can pan that this way and that one that way. You know, it just becomes really fun. The other question you asked me was about musicians or band. All right.
Yeah. Like, how do you like form these connections, and how do you foster these relationships with people?
I mean, listen, we're in a digital age online. Like, you can't imagine how many incredible musicians I'm finding online now on Instagram every day. It's unbelievable. Like, how many, I have like a Rolodex now of like musicians that I found on Instagram that I comment and say, you're super dope or you're fire, da 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 da, and they hit me back, and then I get a hold of them and I'm like, hey, I got a song I'm working on, can I send it to you, and you play the drums on it. Like, what? I'm like, yeah. Like, so I just think we're living in a cool time where you can really find really cool musicians to add to the things that you're doing, and you know, and build relationships, and you know, eventually when it's time to take it out, you know, or take it on in a live format, you know, find your own crew, you know, locally, wherever you are. If you're in New York, find, there's so many amazing musicians in New York and you know, in Jersey as well. Finding those musicians, finding a crew that's like, that fits you, fits your sound, your attitude, everything that you're trying to accomplish. You know, it's not about just picking the first one, right? Like, you might hear a drummer that you like, but it's not about, oh, you're, no, there's like, sometimes you got to go through 11 to get the one, or 30 to get the one, but you go through them, you go through that process until you find that connection with the drummer, the guitarist, the bassist, the keyboardist, whoever it is. And that way, you know, when you're building your band, that it's a creative connection there.
Yeah, connecting online is great. I'm also in this class called the New Music Ensemble in my school, and people come together and play the drums or sing, and we have a show like every season, and it's fun, it's great. It's my favorite class.
That's real cool. Real cool. Well, you got a good song that if a musician has to audition for you and you give them that song to audition, I think they'll have fun playing that. That's a really good song for them to be able to learn. It's really cool.
Yeah, it's got a lot of great energy to it.
Yeah, it's got bite.
And it's relatable. I mean, it sounds real because of your age, you know, so it's genuine, you know. That concludes the student part of it. I would like to quickly just play, an invite for kids who may be watching today from the New York City school system who would be interested in being in the Modern Music Project starting in the fall. So this is a short little clip, and then I'd like to open it up to these guys to ask even more questions if you're up for that.
Yes, sure.
All right, awesome, awesome. So let me just play this quickly. This is for kids who've liked what they've heard today and they would like to audition for the Modern Music Project.
The New York City All-City High School Music Program will be holding auditions at Talent Unlimited High School on June 4th, 5th, and 12th from 9 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. This is where you can audition for the Modern Music Project as well as the other outstanding All-City ensembles. You can learn more about the ensembles and register for the auditions at the QR code listed or follow the tiny URL link that's listed in this video. The All-City High School Modern Music Project is the newest addition to the All-City High School Music Program. Students who display a high level of interest and or ability in songwriting, music production, and contemporary music performance will have an opportunity to audition and participate in this new ensemble hosted at Stuyvesant High School. The Modern Music Project experience includes guest visits by Grammy-winning songwriters, producers, engineers, and music industry executives. The Modern Music Project writes, records, and performs original music and cover songs in contemporary genres like pop, hip-hop, R&B, rock, alternative, and country, while
embracing New York City's central creative role in supporting and even giving birth to some of these genres. The Modern Music Project is looking to work with singers, songwriters, rappers, DJs, beatmakers, composers, instrumental soloists, drummers, bassists, guitarists, keyboardists, and percussionists. We'll see you at the auditions at Talent Unlimited High School on June 4th, 5th, and 12th from 9 a.m. to 12:30 p.m.
All right. So if you're out there and you're into what we're doing here, then please, please come and audition. We would love to have you as part of it. And with that, I'd love to open it up to these guys and, you know, I guess just maybe, you know, kind of raise your hand. Don't step on each other, but go ahead and please enjoy Rodney's wisdom and expertise and creativity. Ella, you want to start?
Yeah. So my question is, like, how do you, like, publicize yourself and, like, kind of put yourself more out there? Because I've, like, tried to put myself on, like, social media platforms and, like, tried to use, like, hashtags and stuff. But, like, I mean, it doesn't go, like, viral. And, like, I want to know, like, how I can get more people to, like, see my stuff.
I'm sorry. You know what's funny is that viral, sometimes when you're trying to go viral, it doesn't happen, right? You know, I have an artist that signed under us and for months, like, we're like trying to crack this whole viral code. Like, yeah, how are we going to do this? And if we do it this way, it's going to go viral. And we do it this way to go viral and it never happens. And then one day he just like does a remake of a simple song and then it gets like 20 plus million views. It's just like, and it's following from 70,000 to 200 something thousand in like eight weeks. So it's just like, okay. You know, so I would say, don't try to go viral, right? Be authentic, you know, make authentic music, be authentic to yourself. And I would say, you know, I do think social media is a strong way to publicize, though. I do think, you know, your age group especially is where kids live. You know, and I think that's the way I would market my music is through social media. You know, I would research if there's any opportunities to perform or be part of like what he just publicized and be part of different things where people will be publicizing you on their page. I would try to sign myself up for different things like that.
Excellent. Julia, your hand was up second.
So, I wanted to ask how, like, as a songwriter and I guess as a producer as well, you overcome writer's block, because I think this is a thing that not only I struggle with, but everyone else does when writing music. Because I think there comes a point when you're writing and, like, for me, I don't know what to call it. Just, like, maybe, like, being, like, usually when I'm writing songs, I'm, like, in the zone and I'm like, oh, this sounds good. Like, I vibe with this. This is great. And then all of a sudden, like, it kind of just runs out. And yeah. I don't know if like usually I'll do one or two things, one of them being I just write through it. Or do you think it's better to just take a step back and reflect on what you've written? Like which way do you think is the best?
I think you have to go away from it actually. Like it doesn't hurt to even leave it and come back a day later, 2 days later, 3 days later, a week later. But sometimes you have to leave that particular idea and go to a different idea. You know, it's funny because when I was around your age, the way I created was I created in a way of ideas and not full songs. So what I would, because I wanted to get so much out of me. So and so I would create 10 song ideas in a day, right? And then the next day I'll wake up and then I go and I do it again. And then I would go back and I'll listen to 20 ideas and I would, okay, that one has a lot of potential. That one has a lot of potential. And I would go and perfect the two or three that really stood out to me. So I think that's a great way to try and write. I think another thing as far as writer's block is, it's unpredictable, of course. But for me, what I used to do was I used to just get away from it, walk away from it. Go hang out with your friends, go get on the phone, get away from it, and then come back and then you should be okay. You should be able to get back into it.
Okay, Thank you, because I think there's always, like, especially if I have, like, a good song idea, this fear of walking away from it, because I feel like I'm never going to get it back again. So I think
that's... I don't ever think that. You know, I don't ever think that. As long as you have something recording you, right? So what you always want to do is, you know, record every moment. And your creativity doesn't come for it to leave us, right? That's not the purpose of creativity. It's not for us to have a great idea and for it to walk away from us. You know, we have the power and the control to walk away from it and then come back to it and finish it.
Yeah, that's great.
Thank you.
That's awesome. Thank you for asking that question too. Angel, you're next.
Okay, a few things. It seems like me and Sophia had the same question about, like, would we have to re-audition in June when you have those auditions?
No.
No, okay. Also, a couple of things. One, you said the dates for the auditions, just because of another thing, were June 4th, 5th, and
12th.
Was the third one? The 12th?
Yes.
Okay. At Talent Unlimited.
That's right.
Cool. It just really surprised me, and it was, like, awesome to hear, because one of my friends who's amazing at the piano, he's so much better than me, but I wanted him to do this, and Talent, man, I can't speak. Talent Unlimited is the school he goes to, so that's just really, like, that's really cool.
Excellent. Yeah, okay, spread the word. I mean, the more creative people that we have together on Saturdays, the better everything's going to be for everybody, you know? So the more the merrier. Sophia, your hand was up. Did you have a question?
Oh, yes. Like, I had a question about, like, when is it good to, like, stop perfecting a song? Because, like, I'm always trying to, like, I'm always like, oh, this doesn't feel right. Oh, I have to change it. Like, does this sound good? And I'm just like, I'm afraid I'm, like, annoying others when I'm like, oh, like, this just seems wrong. Like, when is it, like, a good time to, like, stop, like, continuously editing, like, your work? Because, like, I'm always doing that. I'm always.
I do that as well. I think instinctively, you know, you're probably a perfectionist, right? And yeah. You have to have a second set of ears to listen, to let you know that, you know, that's why there's A&Rs in the music business. That's why there's people, managers and different people that will say, no, you need to send that out now, Rodney. Like, you got to go. Like, that's like, it feels good. Like, let it go. So sometimes you just have to have other people listen to, you know, in the process of your work process, bounce it down and pass it around. Let your friends hear, let different people hear it and check out their reactions. Because sometimes when you're really close to the music that you create, right, you will become somewhat of a, like, it's not ready, and you can spend a lot of time on something that might have been done weeks ago. You know, I'm gonna tell you one process that was very agonizing to me, right? So it's funny because I literally just saw the CD in my house. I found an old CD case, and I was working with Michael Jackson, and Michael used to have this thing where he would, we would be mixing, and every day was a different mix. And I just found a CD case, and guess what mix it said? 31. So that let me know that song, we mixed 31 days. And it still wasn't complete. It still wasn't complete because it said it didn't have the final thing on it that I know what he puts on it when it's complete. So, but it's like, sometimes that's just, to me now, of course, I was young when I worked with Michael. I was only 21 years old. Now, as I'm older, I can look back and know that that was probably overkill. You know what I mean? We probably spent too much time trying to be perfect. And sometimes the greatest perfection is imperfection.
What do you mean by that?
Like, so when I'm working on music, sometimes I'll make a mistake when I'm doing that. I know it's a mistake, and I know I need to go back and I can and correct that note or correct that chord or whatever it is. But sometimes there's beauty in that mistake. And it's like, no, that was actually cool. Like, I made the mistake, but it actually, when I listen back, for me, I know it was wrong, but the people listening to it, they hear it as like, it's beautiful. Like, don't touch it. That's great. So sometimes your flaws become your perfection.
That's great.
And just not overthinking, you know, overthinking the process of it all. You know what I mean? Like music is music. You know what makes some of the greatest rock bands and the greatest funk bands ever is that they just go in a room and they press record and they're just going for hours. They're just pushing record and then they come back and chop it all together to make their song. And it's because they were just going. It wasn't a thing of trying to be perfect or trying to be this. And that's why you can listen to great songs historically that might have not had the tightest intro or might have not had the best outro, whatever it was, but they become one of the biggest hits ever is because there was imperfection in it, and that imperfection was actually perfection.
Yeah, I mean, people respond to energy, right? So it's all about energy, you know, how it makes you feel, and does it seem genuine, you know, and is it unique, and how and just emotionally how it hits you. So that's incredible stuff. We're basically at time. I mean, if anybody has maybe one last question, I don't want to hold Rodney too long. I mean, I think we covered a lot of ground, and I think you guys gave, you know, you guys, everybody just did an incredible job. It's a really nice master session. So I thank you. I'm going to play the Rodney, before I do that, is there anything else that you want to say before I play the thank you reel for the end here?
Yeah, no, I just want to thank you all for having me. Thank you, April. Thank you, Harold. And thank you, wonderful students, for just sharing your gift with me today and allowing me to listen to, you know, what's to become and what the future looks like. I can honestly say the future is bright. So thank you so much.
And I'd like to just say thank you from all of us at the Songwriters Hall of Fame. We're so grateful for you being here today. And we are, again, just very thankful.
Yeah, it was incredible. Thank you so much, Rodney. Really. From New York City to LA and New Jersey, original hometown.
Today's Songwriters Hall of Fame Master Sessions at Stuyvesant High School would not have been possible without the talent, foresight, wisdom, and outreach of dedicated members of the Songwriters Hall of Fame New York Education Committee. I would like to personally thank Linda Moran, President and CEO of the Songwriters Hall of Fame, April Anderson, Marketing and Communications Director of the Songwriters Hall of Fame, Francesca McAuliffe, AP of World Languages, Art, and Music here at Stuyvesant High School, as well as Sing You, our principal, for their support and encouragement in putting today's event together. And a big shout out to Simone Dixon and David Gray from Universal Music Publishing Group, Shira Gons from the Mayor's Office of Media and Entertainment, and last but not least, Liz Guglielmo and Robert Lamont from the Office of Arts and Special Projects. Keep up the amazing work. Stay healthy, everyone, and keep the faith. Until next time.